This is the third and final video in a short series on the spherical capacitor. And in this video, we're going to compute the energy stored in the spherical capacitor in two different ways. First, we use a standard formula for the energy stored in a capacitor. And that's this one right here. The energy stored in the capacitor is 1/2 QV. And then second, we approach the problem as a physical integral of the electric field energy density. That's this formula right here. And we integrate that over the region between the two charged shells of the capacitor. So on the left, we have our spherical capacitor, and that's made of two concentric charged conducting shells. The inner shell has a radius of A and a charge of plus Q on it, and the outer shell has a radius of B and a charge of minus Q on it. There's an electric field between the plates pointing radially outward, and we've already computed that field magnitude in the first video. So there's our field magnitude between the plates of the capacitor, that's Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 r squared. And this was derived using Gauss's law, and I'll post a link to that derivation at the top. In the second video, we found the potential difference between the two shells. So that turned out to be Q times the quantity B minus A over 4 pi epsilon 0 AB. And we used that to quickly find the capacitance of the spherical capacitor, and that turned out to be 4 pi epsilon 0 AB over B minus A. And again, I'll post a link to that video at the top. So when we set out to find the energy stored in this capacitor, again, I could directly quote this formula, U equals 1/2 QV, but I want to point out that I normally remember this as U equals 1/2 CV squared. And I'll post a link to where that was originally derived. But then what we do is we place the capacitance with its definition as charge over potential difference, or Q over V. One of those V's cancels, and we end up with 1/2 QV, which is a more convenient way to do it in this particular problem, because all we have to do now is take the potential difference between the two plates and just multiply by another factor of Q and a factor of 1/2 out in front. So I end up with my energy being Q squared times the quantity B minus A. And because of the factor of 1/2 out in front, this is now an 8 pi epsilon 0 AB. So there's the energy stored in the spherical capacitor. Now we could just stop here and say we've got the answer, but the electric field energy density gives us an alternative approach to the problem. And it's a wonderful opportunity to use physical integration to verify our result. So for this approach, we just need our electric field magnitude between the two conductors. And again, our electric field energy density is given by 1/2 epsilon 0 E squared. And I'll post a link to the derivation of that fact up at the top real quick. So all we have to do is plug in the electric field magnitude into the energy density formula. And so for our energy density, we ended up with 1/2 epsilon 0 times the electric field magnitude squared. So we're going to square this Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 r squared. So this gives us 1/2 epsilon 0 times Q squared over 16 pi squared epsilon 0 squared r to the fourth. And then we can clean a few things up. We cancel one factor of epsilon 0, and our numerator is going to be Q squared. And then in the denominator, we can combine the 2 with the 16 and get a 32. So we have 32 pi squared epsilon 0 r to the fourth. And we'll just keep a copy of that over in the middle. Now we notice that the energy density is dropping off with the fourth power of r. In other words, as we get farther from the center. Because the energy density isn't constant in the region between the two shells, we can't just multiply the energy density by the volume between those shells. Instead, we need to divide the volume into thin spherical shells. And the rationale here is that the energy density does have a well-defined value within the thin wall of each of those shells, since the entire volume of the shell is located at just one distance r from the center. So we have a thin spherical shell of radius r between the inner and outer conductors. The thickness of the shell wall is a small increment of radius that we'll call dr, and we're calling the volume within that shell wall dv. So all we have to do now is multiply the energy density, little u, by the volume of this thin shell wall dv, and we'll get an expression for the energy contained in a single thin shell. Well, first we need to have an expression for dv, and that's going to be the surface area of the spherical shell, remember that's 4 pi r squared, multiplied by its thickness dr. So there's the volume contained in that shell wall. It's 4 pi r squared dr. So now we're left with energy density as a function of r and the incremental volume of each spherical shell dv. And all we have to do is multiply these to get the incremental contribution to the energy stored in the capacitor. So we're going to say the energy contribution due to this single shell, we'll call that D capital U, is given by little u times dV, the energy density multiplied by the volume of that thin spherical shell wall. And now we just have to plug everything in. So little u was given by q squared over 32 pi squared epsilon 0 r to the fourth. And then dV is given by 4 pi r squared dr. And we can start cleaning things up. We can cancel a factor of 4. That'll leave us with an 8 in the denominator. One of our factors of pi is going to cancel, so we have a single pi in the denominator. Our q squared is a spectator up there in the numerator. Our epsilon 0 is a spectator. And then two factors of r are going to cancel, leaving me with an r squared in the denominator. So now our contribution to the total energy has been written in terms of a single variable r, and we can use integration to add all of these up. And I'll say our total energy u is the sum of all the du's. This is what integration does. So we slap an integral sign on there, and that says that we're summing up all those energy contributions. If we put in our expression for du in terms of r, it's clear that r is the integration variable here, and we need to go from the initial value to the final value. So we go from the inner shell, where r was equal to a, to the outer shell, where r was equal to b. Now, everything in this integrand is a constant, except for the 1 over r squared, and that integrates to negative 1 over r. And we're going to evaluate this across the limits of integration from a to b. Now, subbing in the upper limit into this expression, we would get a negative 1 over b, and then when we subtract what we get by subbing in the lower limit, we would get a plus 1 over a. I'd rather write the positive term out in front. So I'm going to write my next step as q squared over 8 pi epsilon 0, 1 over a minus 1 over b. Now all we need to do is get a common denominator on those two fractions. So we multiply the first one by b over b, the second one by a over a. That gives us a b minus a in the numerator. So q squared times the quantity b minus a, and then an 8 pi epsilon 0 AB in the denominator. And that's the same answer we got using the standard formula for the energy stored in a capacitor. So we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab. And best of luck on your math and physics journey.